parts that I prepared. So I will just be starting with those. And afterwards, Attorney Conte has some remarks that he has prepared as well. I am disappointed. I'm mostly disappointed in the fact that we are not surprised. I'm disappointed that it would be a rarity to find a Black person who lives in this city who is surprised. I am beyond disgusted that Dreasjon's family was denied justice, that Dreasjon will not be afforded the privilege of finding justice inside of a criminal courtroom. In this case, the flaws of the justice system have been brought to the surface once again. In this state and every other state around the country, just one eyewitness's testimony is sufficient to convict a murderer. In this case, we know that there were at least 10 eyewitnesses, most of whom testified before the grand jury. Their testimony was consistent. Dreasjon was tased. He fell. He was shot while still shaking on the ground. He did not shoot back. We were reminded after the Breonna Taylor decision that the chances of an indictment against the police are always slim. That even after an international campaign for justice for a Black woman killed while fast asleep in her bed, nothing happened. How much more disfavored would Dreasjon be after he dared to run? After he dared to fall, after having electricity pumped through his body, after he dared to move, after he was shot again and 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 again. That DeJour Mercer did not stop shooting until Dreasjon stopped moving, until Dreasjon stopped breathing, until his life was gone and he was not here anymore. And all that was left was a memory and grief and pain and tears and blood and a tent. A tent that sits on Michigan Road in a grassy field. A tent that holds memories of him and his hopes and his dreams. A dream-catching tent that has been burned, that has been ripped, that has been vandalized again and again, but now stands again. This dream catcher represents all of our dreams, Black people's dreams, our American dream, Martin's dream, Malcolm's dream, the dream of a litany of civil rights martyrs. Our American dream has become a nightmare. A nightmare that replays every day. A nightmare grounded in dashed hopes. The resolve that you saw, the pain that was palpable, the streets that bubbled all summer long, was from a dream that has long been deferred. A dream that has never quite been within our collective reach. It does not escape us that this decision was made before the grand jury convened. It does not escape us that the election, that politics, that standing in the community have all come into play. We know that the system is functioning as intended and is fully operational in doing what it was meant to do, in acquiring justice for some, but not for all. And we know that people still find room to be elitist, to be apathetic, to stick their heads in the proverbial sand, even within a system that's designed to oppress them and people who look like them. Our role in the criminal portion of this case was non-existent. We do not represent the state. We do not decide on charges to present to a grand jury. We are not prosecutors. We are not judges. So far, we have functioned merely as victim advocates. And in that capacity, we have never seen so much corruption. We have never seen so much complacency. Notwithstanding, we are prepared to move forward with the civil portion of this case, because DeJour Mercer must be held accountable for the life he took. The city must answer for their role in hiring people like him. Their answer must consist of more than them thinking that Dreasjon was nothing that his life didn't matter, that he was just another superhuman 150-pound black man who could withstand more than a dozen bullets and a taser and still with his head hanging half off, get up, turn over, and shoot bullets that no one sees while using his dark magic to conjure a mass hallucination. Dreasjon's family is heartbroken, but the fight will continue. And now it's our turn. It will not be an easy fight, but we are ready. I am heavily insulated from any ire that has been thrown my way. I can take it. It is not a burden. I'm not beholden to anyone or any office. The burden here has been on his family. The burden here has been trying to understand the people who have no stake in this matter and who choose to harass, to incite, to trouble Dreasjon's family. His family is my only concern. Just as some people would prefer not to see me again, some people who thought we would shut up and sit down and eat crow after this decision, I would love to never have to do this again, to never have to fight this fight again. But if the way this case unfolded and the things that led up to the death of this young man and this decision of this grand jury, if they happen again, if they're not fully addressed, if people with power go through the motions to placate the masses with no intention of truth-telling or taking accountability, I will be back here next year saying this again, giving this same speech about the next person that is taken. This will happen again. It does not have to, but it will take all of us to stop it. We need you. We need the people of Indianapolis to say that enough is enough. Enough injustice for the Michael Taylors and Dreasjon Reeds of our community. Enough of mothers, fathers, sisters, brothers, friends mourning in the streets. Enough diatribes about how demands not to be slaughtered amount to not appreciating the good cops. What does it matter that there are good cops when the bad ones roam with impunity? We did not create a public relations crisis for you, IMPD. You did that. Own it. People do not trust you because of you. People of Indianapolis, we have had enough. We have had enough talking. It's time to own our power. It's time to act. People of Indianapolis, our power is evident when we come together. Please continue to fight for the justice that Dreasjon deserves. Please know that we will fight as long as breath is in us. May Dreasjon rest in power and more power to the people.
Thank you, Fatima, for a very strong sentiment. This is Attorney Suarez Kante with the law firm of Fatima Johnson. As you all know, on November 10th, just this week, the special prosecutor announced that the grand jury would not indict Officer Mercer. As Fatima indicated, we were very disappointed, but actually not surprised, because that's the system, that's how it works. But what caught our attention is that just after that, there was a press conference by the Indiana State Police. I suppose that press conference was to tell the public the evidence that they presented before the grand jury, evidence that justified the actions of Dreasjon, of Sam Mercer. We have looked at the evidence and we were surprised that they even had the audacity to present that evidence to the public, because that evidence actually support the proposition that Mr. Officer Mercer should have been indicted. Now, right from the beginning of this case, the IMPD was adamant that Mercer rained all those bullets on Dreasjon because he shot at him first. We've looked at the evidence, even in their own statements. It's very clear that Dreasjon did not shoot at Officer Mercer at all. We are going to review the evidence with you this morning and show you the parts of the evidence that really support what we've been saying all along, that Dreasjon never shot at Officer Mercer. Can we play that video, please? part of the video. 10.
This is that overlapping that rock, and this is 6 and 7. So you get that wave pattern of one shot, and then you immediately, just in the milliseconds, get that second shot at the same time. This is the overlapping cases. Is it going?
Can we play the video of the chase? The chase. When Officer Mercer was chasing Dreasjon. Can we play that? Do we have that ready? No. Okay, that's fine. This one. Well, in that video, if we watched the TV broadcast of the press conference, about 10 minutes in that press conference by the Indiana State Police, you will see Officer Mercer chasing Dreasjon. It's very clear on that video. He actually got straight up on him and chased him, and he fell to the ground. And then he pulled back and started shooting at him. It's very clear evidence. There was nowhere where you would see Dreasjon getting up on his butt or any part of his body to shoot at Officer Mercer. It's very clear. And I can tell you that the explanation they gave regarding the gunshots, there were like 13 straight up gunshots. What they told the public is that after the sixth or the seventh shot, that was crossfire. That means that by the sixth to the seventh shot, Dreasjon would have shot at Officer Mercer. That's a clear indication as to who shot first. So the first five shots then were fired by Officer Mercer. If we even accept their own theory, that is 6 to 7 shot that was crossfire. That tells you who first shot. It was clearly Officer Mercer. Now, their explanation somehow that Dreasjon got up after the first shot, that Dreasjon got up when he was tased and tried to shoot at Officer Mercer, is not even supported by the video. Detective Lieutenant Heron, he was asked that question point blank during his press conference, whether he can tell who shot first. He could not say. He didn't know definitively who shot first. It's very clear from his own evidence that Officer Mercer shot first. Now, there were witnesses, just like Fatima said. They didn't know who shot first according to their own evidence, but there were at least 9 witnesses who testified. They actually testified consistently. They never saw Dreasjon shoot at Officer Mercer. It was Officer Mercer that started shooting at him. No witness saw Dreasjon shoot at Officer Mercer. Guess what? During the press conference, Lieutenant Heron conveniently did not talk about the eyewitnesses who testified before the grand jury. In fact, he said, we interviewed a few witnesses, but did not say what the witnesses told them. That tells you something. You know, so there were many, many other errors in that press conference. For example, take the weapon. The weapon, you know, they had this big analysis about the weapon, where it was found. But they showed us a video of one of the officers, Bagers, moving the so-called weapon. We don't know from where, and placing it somewhere else. Well, the explanation they gave was that they were doing that for the safety of the medical personnel. That's why they moved the video, I mean, the gun. Well, guess what? The medical personnel did not come there until maybe 40, 45 minutes later. They had the opportunity to simply take a picture of the weapon where it was found on Dreasjon. They didn't do that. They moved it. Let's say it was Dreasjon's gun. Was it in his pocket? Well, we have transcriptions of the conversation between the police officers that tend to indicate that he had some taser in his pocket. If they had taken a picture of that gun, we would know whether Dreasjon had the gun in his hand, or even if it was his gun, whether it was still in his band or in his pocket. They didn't do that. They moved the gun and claimed that it was for the safety of the security of the medical personnel. During the press conference also, Lieutenant Heron was asked whether he had taken, whether they did any tests on Dreasjon's hands to see if there was any gun residue, any bullet residue. He could not answer that question. Instead, he went to this theory about, well, it would have shown false positive, false negative, but that's not the question. Did you do that? If he had shot, you would see residue in his hands. They didn't do that. In fact, he ran and started talking about DNA evidence to associate the gun with Dreasjon. Guess what they didn't do? They didn't do fingerprints. Wanted to know whose hand was Mercer's hands on that, did Mercer touch that gun? You know, because we see him almost grabbing Dreasjon during the chase. Did he touch the gun? We don't know, because they quickly removed the gun and never took a picture of where the gun was located, if at all. Now, the claim that Dreasjon shot, you know, stood, you know, got up on his buttocks and shot at Officer Mercer is purely speculative. Even though they started their conference by saying, you are not going to speculate. When you ask them, well, how did you get this evidence? They said it's the ballistic person. Really? You know, we had eyewitnesses. Did they say anything about the eyewitnesses? No. They are relying on ballistic evidence to show that Dreasjon was moving his body. Now, you have to ask yourself, why is it, you know, that none of the eyewitness testimony was included in the public display that was shown on Tuesday, November the 10th? You know, Fatima did mention Breonna Taylor. In her case, the police officer there was indicted on a very minor offense based solely on what one eyewitness said. Just one eyewitness in the Breonna Taylor's case, one eyewitness testimony was sufficient to indict a police officer. I can tell you in this case, and we produced that evidence in due course, there were multiple eyewitnesses who actually saw what happened. Most of their evidence, because if you agree with Lieutenant Taylor, he didn't know who shot first. So all of their claim is based on pure speculation when you disregard the testimony of the eyewitnesses. There were other multiple problems with that presentation that we saw that day on with detective, with Lieutenant Heron. Multiple problems. And then, that really bothered me. You know, something bothered me with that presentation. First, the detective, the lieutenant, they said he'd been with the police for 35 years, you know, and in order to poison the public, He went into details that I'm really not going to dignify in this presentation regarding how Dreasjon acquired the gun, if he did have that gun with him. The young man is dead. He's not here to defend himself. All the lieutenant was doing was besmirch his character, that he stole the gun. He had, you know, people get charged with crimes all the time. I mean, we believe that even after if he agreed that he had the gun, you know, he flew to Indianapolis from Texas. He didn't drive here. You know, everything that he came with was legally obtained. So for him to bring in that comment about Dreasjon stealing the gun, which is completely inappropriate, even if he stole the gun, they didn't have a right to be shooting, to shoot at him the way Officer Master did. There's really no reason for that. It does not come into play. The issue was not whether how the gun was acquired, if at all he owned the gun. The issue in this case, what caused Officer Mercer to shoot so violently at Dreasjon? They admit that Officer Mercer tased him. Consistent with what the eyewitnesses said, when he tased him, he fell. And if you look at that video, you see, when he fell down, the boy was convulsing. They claimed that he was pulling. He was making a draw. That's one of the comments Detective Lieutenant Heron made. He showed a picture of hand movement. Well, guess what? If you look at the video of the chase, Dreasjon was running with two phones on his right hand and a shirt on his left hand. Did they mention that? No. How did he shoot? How did he draw? They just showed movement of the hands. It's not in the movement, it's a static picture of his hand. They say he was drawing. There's nothing on that video or nothing on that picture that would slightly indicate that he was drawing any gun. You understand? So we have more to say. You know, we are just asking the public to review the evidence that was presented by the state. You will see that it's a very shallow piece of work, and Mr. Officer Mercer should have been indicted, and he had the opportunity to prove his innocence in court. Thank you.
We're now ready to take any questions that you may have. Please submit them in the Q&A, and we'll answer as many as we can. Thank you.
Okay.
She's going to unmute them.
Fox 59, I'll allow you to answer, ask your question live, please.
All right, would this be me? Good morning, thank you. As you can see, I asked a number of questions, so maybe we can go through them one at a time. Will the attorneys or the family release any of the evidence and information that it has garnered, such as the pathology report?
Okay. Well, we are in federal court right now. There's a limit to what we can do in terms of the evidence that we have. As you know, most of the commentary that we've made is regarding what they propose, what they put forth to the public. We, as attorneys for the family, we're bound by certain rules of evidence and certain rules of court. So at some point, this evidence will be made available. But right now, we're not going to commit to releasing any specific evidence.
Okay. Does the family have any sort of message for the protesters or those who may use their reaction to the grand jury decision as an excuse to potentially bring violence out into the streets of Indianapolis?
The family has no message for the protesters.
Would the family consider any sort of a message that would say respecting the memory of Dreasjon and the need for criminal justice reform in Indianapolis, but it would be hopeful that any sort of protest would be peaceful?
No. Well, listen, the family of Dreasjon is not a violent family. Peace-loving people. Although violence has been inflicted upon that family, they don't want anyone to respond in kind. However, they are not. They do support the public, actions of the public to protest peacefully. I think they have a right to do so. This will only help to bring changes to the system. So they're not encouraging violence, but they do support the rights of people to protest.
Speaking of seeking changes to the system, in recent lawsuits that have some similarities, for instance, the recent BLM ND10 lawsuit regarding the use of tear gas, and also, of course, the case of Aaron Bailey's family from a police action shooting from a couple years ago. Would the family consider settlement talks that perhaps would result in a settlement reward, as well as, let's say, commitments on behalf of IMPD to change some of its practices, policies, and training?
I think that everything is still on the table right now. There's only a limit to what we can do, but this is an opportunity for some changes to be made, for some substantive changes to be made. And some of those can be made through a settlement. So nothing's off the table.
Thank you, Fox 59. Lydia, you're up next, please. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Lydia Gerke. I'm a reporter with the Indy Star. And I was just wondering, what are the next legal steps, if any, that your office is planning to take right now?
Well, we have taken legal steps. We have taken legal steps. The case is in court, in federal court at this point. Now, we had to hold back because of issues regarding Fifth Amendment rights for some of the individuals who are defendants in the case. So we are going to push forward with our case because now we've heard what the grand jury has to say. So no one can come before us and start pleading the Fifth. So we're going to start talking to these people in a forum that we choose.
Thank you. Troy Washington, you're next.
Hi. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Okay, originally I was going to ask what's next, where do we go from here when it comes to getting closure for the family? But when the decision came down, Reed's sister kind of talked about how she's still hoping for justice and that all of this comes down to sending a message so that this doesn't continue to happen because we're seeing it so much across our nation. So is that the underlying message here to make sure that going forward, things like this, they don't just go away?
I don't think that things like this will ever go away because they will not stop unless something happens. If this is the ebb and flow of, you know, and we have this circular pattern of somebody gets shot, everybody's mad, nothing happens, everybody's not mad. Somebody else gets shot, everybody's mad, nothing happens, everybody's not mad anymore. There's going to become a time when that roller coaster is going to, and the feelings that people have are going to hit a fever pitch. And you know, I don't want to be in the position to even as a spokesperson for this family, even with this family in this very room that I sit in, I don't want to be in the position for, or put them in the position to have to explain, you know, what people feel outside of their family, or what people are, or what messages people should take from this, or what lessons they should learn. Because they did not ask for what's been given to them. And now they're being asked to control the public. Now they're being asked to explain what happened to their family, what their family member was going through his mind. And he's not here to tell us because he was taken. They're being asked to do a lot of things. The message is, don't put people in this position again. And if you keep putting people in this position, then the consequences thereof are on you. They want a magic wand to just wipe away what happened, and for someone to come and speak nice words and preach love and preach forgiveness and preach happiness and preach hope. And it's really hard to do in the disheartening era of which we live. It's really hard to do after the 50th time, after the 60th time. It's really, really hard to do. I'm quite tired of Black people, of being asked to be the peacemakers, to be the branch giver, the olive branch givers. This was a mistake for them, because this one will not go away. This man will not be forgotten. He was loved. He was loved immensely. And that's where they messed up, because they thought this was nobody, and he was somebody.
Thank you. Wanda Nguyen, you're next, please.
Hello. I just have a couple of questions. The first one is, do you believe that Mercer will be forced to resign at any given time?
Well, resign, we really have no, you know, no, we don't care what they do with him. As far as we know, he should be in jail right now. That's something that IMPD has to decide. If they want to keep someone like that who is quick to take out his weapon and murder someone, that's their call. We are going to pursue him the civil way that we know. They can decide whether they want to keep him in the force.
That should be one of the things that's on the table as well.
And I think that he's going to have a lot of trouble staying staying in his job, staying in his house, staying in his life, and going about town as if everything's normal, because everyone knows what he did. And you know, that's something that he has to deal with. If he can't sleep, he's not the only one who can't sleep. And he did it. So that's his business.
Thank you. Devontae, you're next, please. We'll move to Tom Davies. Thank you.
Hello, thank you. Will you be with the new evidence or the evidence that was presented by the state police and what you found out from that, will you be making any changes in what you present in your federal lawsuit? Does that change your stance in any of the allegations you've included in that?
Well, I think the evidence they presented makes our civil case easier. I think so, because it does show us what we've been saying all along. They do admit, you know, contrary to the claims they were making before, that Dreasjon started shooting at the Officer Mercer. They admit that's not the case, even in their own statement. So we're going to use what they have and then use what we have to make sure that the rights of Dreasjon and his family are fully redressed. So we're not going to make any substantive changes. We knew where the evidence was going to go, and we knew it because we've seen the videos and stuff. So their case has buttressed our position.
Jessica Louise, you're next. Thank you.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
I'm sorry, do you have a question?
Yes, I do. I'm sorry. My name is Josh, and I've been out here with you guys as well. So this has been dating back since 1987, back when IMPD officers shot and killed Michael Taylor Jr. in the head while he was in their custody, and they tried to present some evidence in that grand jury trial as well that, you know, Michael Taylor Jr. somehow, with handcuffs being on, grabbed a pistol and shot himself in the head, which is kind of weird. So this keeps happening here. We the people are mad. Like Fatima just said earlier, we're mad. This happens, we get mad, we yell peacefully, no justice, no peace. You tell us that there's going to be change, but then there's no change because this keeps happening. So what can we do more legally or on a legal term to help try to push for a better reform system? Because I have nephews and nieces who are having boys, and I don't want that to happen to them, and I don't want it to happen to me. And the fact that it had already happened to my cousin Michael Taylor Jr. And I'm standing very close to the Reed family as of Jamie's Reed side, we just want to know, like, what more can we do, because yelling in these streets is not getting us nowhere.
Okay, well, that's a very good observation that you just made there. Like this, like you pointed out, this has been happening since 1986, and it seemed to happen every year. There have been no substantive changes. I think folks should start maybe participating in politics, you know. For example, look at this case. We started from the beginning. We said this case should have been given to a federal agency. Nobody listened to us. The investigation was handed over to the state police. And I was kind of, it was interesting to me that during his presentation on Tuesday, Lieutenant Heron said something about that the IMPD did a very great job. And I'm like, really? They did a great job? You know, so if you are going to be, if an agency has to investigate cases like this, you can't let the same people. I mean, Indiana State Police and the IMPD, really? I don't see any difference between those two entities. And just the amount of praise that Heron heaped upon IMPD tells me, you know, if that's what's going to happen, if that's what, you know, stuff like that is going to continue to happen, we're going to get the same result. They shoot some young man, they give the case to the Indiana State Police to investigate, the IMPD, they all hang around, and then they come to the same conclusion. So maybe we should participate more fully in politics, I suppose. I don't know.
Samantha Buran, you're next, please.
Hi. So you kind of got into what I was going to be asking, but it's, are you and the family still advocating for an independent and federal investigation into the murder of Dreasjon? Is that still legally feasible at this point? And if so, are there certain elected officials that members of the public can be calling upon to help elevate that call?
Okay. Well, I think it's still feasible, you know, because the federal agency, government, has the right to investigate to determine whether or not Dreasjon's civil rights were violated. So that's not, apart from the criminal charges, I think the federal government is able to do that, you know, to come in and investigate. But at this point, maybe the community can do that, put pressure on the federal government to do that. We are now going to focus our attention on the civil case that we have in court, because to us, this should have been done a long time ago. So if folks need to contact the U.S. Attorney's Office to see if an independent investigation can be done to determine whether Dreasjon's civil rights were violated, more power to the public.
I also want to ask that the public, when they get notices to participate in a jury, that they respond to them, because very often the jury is not representative of the community. And that plays a part in decisions like we see as well.
Thank you. Nigel Powers, you're next, please.
Yeah, so first of all, I wanted to know if this is still a march plan for today. And also just wanted to add on to the fact that definitely feel like they definitely want us to be the peacemakers all the time. It is a cycle that just keeps going on, you know, another black man is shot. Everybody's mad. And it's not that, at least for me, that we are not still angry. It's that it's hard to even keep track. Blood couldn't have made me and Dreasjon closer. I've known him since before I can remember.
Nigel, you're completely right. We are always, that is always the role that we are given in this. The march that is planned for today is an Indy Black Lives Matter march. It's still going on. It's right after this. As a matter of fact, we are wrapping up because we are, you know, to do so that the march can start. Is this the last question?
We're going to take two more questions. Nigel, you didn't ask the question that you typed in. If you're asking a question, please only ask the question that you typed in, because those are the ones that you're authorized to ask the attorneys. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Sorry.
Fox 59, you had one more question? I guess that concludes our Q&A. Thank you very much for attending. We, the attorneys, will not be answering any more questions for today. Get home safely. Thank you.